Hello everyone and welcome back to What's Left of America. I'm John Iadarola and I'll be walking you through an hour for what passes for news in this country. And joining me as always on this most fantastic of days, Francesca Fiorentini. How's it going?
Our Lord and patron saint of the Monday.
Glad to have you here.
I miss commuting. I mean, actually I don't. Yeah. I gave up a full-time job a while ago. But does anyone else like miss a Monday morning commute? Just to leave their house and feel human, you know?
I mean, there's a reason I'm in this big abandoned building. It's because I pushed to be the first back. Because I wanna go places, I wanna do something new. I don't want much of a commute, but the 3 miles I have to bike or drive to my place, I'll do that. That's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah. I get it. But supposedly there's some good news on the pandemic, not like in the here and now, that's all nightmares, that's demon souls in real life. But soon, good news, and we'll have that for you in just a little bit. Lots of news to get to, obviously. For those of you who are already watching, please hit the like button because notifications just don't notify anyone. I don't even know why they're called that. They don't work, but you liking it might. You can share the stream or whatever that looks like, try it out. And if you chat along with us, send us tweets and super chats and all that, we'll be responding as we go. Before we jump into our first story though, how was the Bituation Room yesterday? Your show that you do every weekend.
John is such a gentleman. Ladies first, let's talk about me and my show on a different show. Yeah, it was great. Great podcast. Nato Green was back. We had Barbara Smith, who is a kind of legendary black feminist, kind of coined the term identity politics. She was on the phone. It was hard. Listen, as a podcast, it's going to be better, but it was fun. We had a great turnout. So
interesting. You know, I hope that someday I will be a person who coins a term that you then have to release out into the wilderness and it becomes whatever the dumbest, most dishonest people in America want it to be, as every word does.
Everybody misunderstands it, even though it changed the world. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, like political language is basically like season 2 of Stranger Things. You have this cute little thing, this creature that you love, and then you let it out and it becomes a monster because everybody treats it poorly. That's basically how language works.
Like a nerd being like, you're not using it right. It's hard.
Yeah. Anyway, I could go off on a long tangent and probably will despite my best efforts, but lots of other news to get to. So why don't we do that and see what's going on in America. Over the weekend, it looked briefly like Donald Trump was ready to acknowledge reality for the first time in his life. And many people around the country, including people I like, leaped to that and said, oh my God, it's happening. Is he acknowledging he lost the election? And I resisted the urge to do a live video because I suspected that Donald Trump is gonna Donald Trump. And it turns out that he did. Now, what is the clue that got everybody on the edge of their seat? It was Trump tweeting this. He won because the election was rigged. No vote watchers or observers allowed. Vote tabulated by a radical left, a privately owned company, Dominion, with a bad reputation and bum equipment that couldn't even qualify for Texas, which I won by a lot. The fake and silent media and more. Okay, so all of that's just misinformation. Dominion was in a couple states.
What is bum equipment? You mean like, remember the brand from the 90s, like bum equipment? That was like a shirt. Yeah. Anyway, yes, keep going with this ridiculousness.
Yeah. We can try to figure out what bum equipment is, but a lot of this is you have to have Fox News brain to understand any of that. It's nonsense. The first two words are he won, which seems like he's acknowledging that Biden did actually win. But it turns out when people started tweeting, oh my God, look what he did, Trump realized, oh my God, look what I did. And so he started saying things like this. And so this is just a mishmash of the last 2 days of his social media activity. But there are things like, I won the election. But you just admitted you didn't. And understand that I won the election, which when I screen capped it was 2 hours ago, is a slightly lower energy, lower D version of I won the election, which he did 9 hours earlier. So basically he's just waiting like a third of each day to tweet out that he still won the election, even though his court cases are getting thrown out, which we'll talk about. The recounts aren't going his way, which we've talked about. But he's still confident. He has that at this late date.
You know, Nothing says you're a loser more than saying that you won, even though you categorically and objectively lost. Like, you know, this is the, like, if the Tampa Bay Rays were like, we won, everyone would be like, okay, that's not how we play baseball. You know, like, you don't get to just say you won. And when you say you did, literally no one wants to listen to that. It's just pathetic and it's whiny. And this is ostensibly the president. And I love that he thinks that that's correcting his mistake rather than just digging himself, a bigger, sadder hole for his tears to fill it up with. You know, like, he just add a little addendum tweet. We've all done it and be like, you know, asterisk. Like, he only won because, you know, or I meant to put that in air quotes or whatever it is. But I love that we can just fill in his tweet with, I won the election because I refuse to accept reality and because all of the court cases I've presented in multiple states have completely imploded because my lawyer is drunk all the time.
And that's his best quality.
And exactly. Yeah,
you're right. We would never accept this from like a football team, but that's because when it's serious, like the outcome of a sporting event, we care about reality. When it's like fluffy nonsense, like who's gonna be our next president, it's whatever the guy we like says. That's basically how things work. I'm still assuming, and I'm ready to be shown to be naive on this, that eventually he will get out of that building. But this is a sitting president refusing to accept the results of an election that was done free and fair and fully observed. This, while it can be funny, is horrifying because we don't know what comes after this. When he tweets, the radical left Democrats working with their partner, the fake news media, are trying to steal this election. We won't let them. There's a threat. What is behind that threat? What will you do to not let them steal the election from you? And when he says the most fraudulent election in history, after saying a few days ago that it was the most secure election in history. Okay, so he's making pretty clear that he's not going to accept the results of it. So what happens? What happens after that? I don't know. I don't know. But there was one good tweet from Ken Klippenstein who said, I remember leftists years ago saying Trump might refuse to concede and being told they were being hysterical. Exactly, because there's always those anti-lefters who are gonna be like, how dare you be worried about Donald Trump, the damage he's doing and the damage he promises to do in the future. Well, if you predicted that Donald Trump might not accept the results of an election, I don't know what more he needs to do. Aside from tanks in the streets, this is how you refuse to accept the results of an election.
Yeah, and I remember when he first won, everyone was making the same joke, which was basically, oh, basically Donald Trump's first and America's last election. Like, this is the last American election. And it was like, oh, that's such a joke. But like, come on, y'all, we knew there was a grain of truth to that. And everyone was sort of thinking that. And we all saw this moment coming. Like, I love Colbert. I am happy that he did not normalize, and nor should any of us normalize the fact that a sitting president is denying the results of the democracy that we have. But like, let's not be bright-eyed and bushy-tailed about this. Like, we all knew this was a very real possibility. Just set up like two governments, you know, just a White House, build a White House in front of the current White House. I'm like, how do you, again, this is my feeling is you encase, a la Simpsons movie, encase the White House in a bubble. It's a petri dish anyway. It should be sealed off from the rest of the world, and then just build a new White House.
Yeah. Yeah, give him the presidential equivalent of letting your little brother go into the arcade and mash the buttons, but he doesn't actually have any quarters. That's basically what we need. Yeah, and I agree. I'm glad that they haven't normalized it. Yesterday is, you know, season finale of John Oliver, because he's going to be off for a few months because for some reason they treat it as if his show is the Game of Thrones rather than a news show that hypothetically you could do year round. I don't get it. But anyway, he did it all about the refusal to accept the results. And I love Colbert too. You know, I have to give it to him. His reaction to Trump's two Thursdays ago press conference was very heartfelt and raw. I also have to give it to him for the undeniable fact that my Trump impersonation is just an impersonation of Stephen Colbert impersonating Donald Trump. Let's be clear about that. But anyway, I hope that in 2.5 months, we look back a couple weeks into the Joe Biden presidency and say, oh good, we were being a little bit much about that. I hope that we get to that. But until we get to that, I'm not going to just assume that we get to that. And so we're gonna take these threats, which is what they are, as seriously as we feel like we need to.
Yeah, the problem is, John, and I'm of two minds about this, is because we know what happens whenever mainstream media starts to take Donald Trump really seriously, right? They give him a lot of airtime. They take every word he says as verbatim, which is mostly lies. And then he kind of, he is able to do whatever he wants. I mean, I feel like this is how we got Donald Trump in the first place, is that we, sure, you have to treat what he says somewhat seriously, but we took his entire presidential campaign as if it were real, right? And people just kept on running to rubberneck all the ridiculous things he said. So it's like, I am of this mind of keep treating him like a sad little clown and he will go away. And also, oh my God, he could actually try to not leave. Look at the shakeups in the Department of Defense, all of this. Yeah. Time will tell, and I have absolutely every ounce of faith that the American people will take the streets nonviolently, en masse. I am not so certain that the Proud Boys in Trump's camp are going to do the same.
Yeah. Yeah, and I'm glad that you mentioned that about the shakeups too, because look, I feel like, and again, maybe naively, maybe fatally naively, that the military is not going to prop up a Trump dictatorship. But if that was what you were trying to do, what would you do? You'd clear out the top management of the Department of Defense and replace it with people who are known for only one thing, personal loyalty to Donald Trump. What has he done? Cleared out the top level of management of the Department of Defense and replaced it with people who are only known because of their personal loyalty to Trump. He has done that. That is what they did in other countries. And in some of those countries, it worked. You know, for a few decades, they were able to keep a guy in power because they had control of the military. I'm not saying that that's what's going to happen. I feel like that's not possible, that there's too many levels and the generals he hasn't fired yet would stop it. But all of this does sound like the sort of thing scholars find someday. Look how placid they were in the face of this encroaching authoritarianism. And I'm just saying, all of this looks exactly like it would look if it ended with a dictator. That's all I'm saying.
Absolutely. And I think that's the other thing, is that you know, all mainstream outlets and most scholars, you know, are like, well, in the end, democracy will prevail because it's so strong. I mean, the American democracy is super strong. What? Have you been living in the same country we have for 4 years? It's pretty weak, actually. It's like it's a poorly put together IKEA table. It just sways and rocks and it will fall very soon. Like, we've all been living in this democracy. It's not that good. So yes, you're absolutely right that, like, the idea that we're not a tin pot dictatorship, like, we very easily could become that.
Yeah, I love that analogy. You know, and over time you start to think, wait, did I not tighten these bolts enough? But no, you did. It's not you, it's the bolts, it's the table. It was set up to fail. Anyway, yeah, I agree. Donald Trump's ongoing challenges to the results of the recent election aren't exactly going well from his point of view. His campaign is withdrawing a central part of its lawsuit seeking to stop the certification of the election results in Pennsylvania, a must-win state for him, where Democrat Joe Biden beat Trump to capture the state and help win the White House. Ahead of a Tuesday hearing in the case, their campaign dropped the allegation that hundreds of thousands of mail-in and absentee ballots, almost 700,000 to be precise, were illegally processed without its representatives watching. The campaign slimmed down lawsuit filed in federal court on Sunday maintains the aim of blocking the results from being certified, and it maintains its claim that Democratic voters were treated more favorably than Republican voters. Now, this is important because what we're seeing right here is, I think, the perfect example of what this legal strategy is and how the strategy part is not necessarily that tied in with the legal part. So in court, they had been alleging that something like 700,000 votes needed to not be counted, which is insane. And that's not just me saying that. Apparently the judge thought that too. So they're retracting it. but they're pretending that they're not, with one of their campaign spokesmen, Tim Murtaugh, saying the story is completely erroneous. Our lawsuit absolutely still make an issue of those votes. Okay, yes, you're making an issue of them, but you're not claiming that they should be retracted. And the gap there between what they're forced to actually try to do in court, you know, when there's the threat of their lawyers being disbarred and things like that, and the way that they're describing it in public, that's a huge gap there. Very, very weak and flaccid in court, but in person, they're like, they're beating on their chest. No, we're totally still gonna win this thing. Because again, they're pursuing multiple strategies, and one of them to some extent might be the legal strategies, but that is not necessarily the one that they're most interested in the future of. They have to maintain the illusion going forward that they can still win this thing, extract as much money as possible out of their base in pursuit of whatever it is that's happening next for Donald Trump and his family. But Francesca, I don't know, maybe you have a different read on it. What do you think?
I mean, you know, he's gonna need a compound in, you know, Russia, Philippines, Brazil, wherever he's still welcome. So yeah, look, he's gotta get the super PAC going. Gotta pretend he wants to run for president again, even though he totally doesn't want to run for president. He would honestly much rather just be on an old man on Twitter. at which point, by the way, if he ever does leave office, we're just replying to him, okay, boomer, every single tweet. That's it. That is what we will do. But you know, you see Tim Murtaugh, like he's responding to an update that says that there's so little left of the Trump federal lawsuit over the election results. There's no need for an argument session that the judge has scheduled for Tuesday. Like, they're once again just denying reality. And also, there are election observers when votes are counted. And
there were.
Apparently they are also from, I mean, this is, look, like everything in the Trump administration, it actually is great because we now know, like, the head of the Department of the Interior was a guy named Ryan Zinke, I think. Like, right? Like, I didn't know what that even was a role. Like, now thanks to Trump, I'm like, oh, there are election observers in every single count in these state board election offices. That's awesome. You know, good to know. Hey, way to go, democracy. So once again, you know, thank you for educating us. This is like the schoolhouse rocks of government that we've really needed. In fact, I hope they redo schoolhouse rocks just with different Trump blunders and then explain how, you know, that's an actual thing. Yay.
Yeah. And to that point about the observers, Trump is still tweeting as of this morning that they didn't have the observers. His campaign already admitted in court that they did like a week and a half ago. And that's important because if you are one of those people watching this who has family members or friends that have been talking about Dominion or Sharpies or I don't even know what the new conspiracy theories are, and you're wondering, how do I get my loved one to no longer believe this BS? They still believe that there weren't observers when the Trump campaign in court admitted that there were. So the answer is you can't. They will accept whatever they want to accept, whatever they're told to accept, because they are desperately clinging onto a world where Donald Trump will still be president. A world that his lawyers don't seem to be clinging to all that closely anymore.
We need to talk about a relatively new show called the Republic, or UNFTR. As a Young Turks fan, you already know that the government, the media, and corporations are constantly peddling lies that serve the interests of the rich and powerful. But now there's a podcast dedicated to unraveling those lies, debunking the conventional wisdom. In each episode of the Republic, or UNFTR, the host delves into a different historical episode or topic that's generally misunderstood or purposely obfuscated by the so-called powers that be, featuring in-depth research, razor-sharp commentary, and just the right amount of vulgarity, the UNFTR podcast takes a sledgehammer to what you thought you knew about some of the nation's most sacred historical cows. But don't just take my word for it. The New York Times described UNFTR as consistently compelling and educational, aiming to challenge conventional wisdom and upend the historical narratives that were taught in school. For as the great philosopher Yoda once put it, you must unlearn what you have learned. And that's true whether you're in Jedi training or you're uprooting and exposing all the propaganda and disinformation you've been fed over the course of your lifetime. So search for UNFDR in your podcast app today and get ready to get informed, angered, and entertained all at the same time.
In terms of some of the preferential treatment, the lawsuit charges that Democratic-heavy counties violated the law by identifying mail-in ballots before Election Day that had defects, such as lacking an inner secrecy envelope or lacking a voter's signature on the outside envelope so that the voter could fix it and ensure that the vote would count, called curing. The lawsuit says that Republican-heavy counties followed the law and did not provide a notice and cure process, disenfranchising many. Okay, but do you get what's happening here? So they made the process for mail-in ballots so obstacle prone and complicated that some people just trying to do their best could make mistakes. Some election officials thought, well, if their vote doesn't count, that's a bad thing because we live in a democracy, so we're gonna give them an opportunity to make their ballot count. Their ballot that was cast before Election Day and all of that, that just had some sort of technicality that needed to be fixed. The Republican heavy counties decided, we don't want that to happen because screw mail-in ballots. And they've decided, so they disenfranchised some, which I guess hurts them. And they're saying that allowing the curing benefits Democrats because presumably Democrats are more likely to vote by mail. But again, that's only a result we got because you guys demonized mail-in ballots. If you cared about your voters and indeed all voters voting in a democracy, none of this would be a problem. Yeah. And none of it is going to be a problem for the results because this isn't going to result in votes being thrown out. But think about this, if you weren't so focused on wringing the neck of democracy, you might have had a chance to get a few more votes. Maybe the 15,000 you need in Georgia, for instance, to lead to you winning at least that state, if not the Electoral College.
Yeah, I mean, this is the heart of all of these lawsuits is you can't have it both ways. You know, you just can't have it both ways. You can't say, stop the count, ooh, start the count. Okay, we need actual observers on this count. Oh, there were observers? Well, I don't know, burn ballots. Like, what do you, and you can't have a party that has been, because of course, let's be real, it's beyond Trump. It is on down the line on all the, you know, the Republican state legislatures that have fallen in line and obeyed orders to try and suppress as much of the vote as possible. And including mail-in ballots and including their own voters, and then suddenly be like, wait, our voters are suppressed. Like, you did that, dummy. So yeah. Yes, this is the whole thing. You can't have it both ways. And I just, can we just say, it is so perfect that Trump lost by the, not the exact, but close margins to the way that Hillary Clinton lost. I think that is so wonderful because—
I agree.
The Democrats in 2016, if they could have mounted any kind of challenge, they probably would have, right? Let's hope they would have mounted a challenge if it had come down to a certain state or that something looked really fishy. And sadly, and maybe in a good way, good for our democracy, it didn't. Nothing was fishy. She lost, and she lost pretty handily, right? She yeah. won the popular vote. But Trump is losing on both of those counts, and it is just so sit in that loss, buddy. Look at it.
Yeah.
It's exactly what happened to Hillary 4 years ago.
Yeah, and while he's doing that and while he's dragging it out, again, it's not that he's not doing that for some purpose that's benefiting him. He is. He's raising money and whatever. Setting up Trump TV, running on blah blah blah, whatever. Whatever other nightmare we'll someday have to cover and deal with. But also the dragging it out. In the first story we talked about the constant declaring, no, I actually won. He's also drawing out how insane he looks, how sad and pathetic he looks. And it's not just us that thinks that. It's not just us. It's not just lefties that are laughing at him. Judges are laughing at him. So let's go through this. We have when Republican lawyers in Nevada complained their observers weren't close enough if they could not hear everything that poll workers were saying, US District Judge Andrew Gordon pushed back saying, at what point does this get ridiculous? And then ruled against the Republicans. Obviously, because it isn't, again, it isn't about them saying, our poll workers were 23 feet away rather than 18. Because if they'd been 18, they'd been saying they would be saying they should have been 12. It's not about that. It's not about this succeeding and getting rid of those ballots. They know they don't have a Trump's chance in hell of winning that. But it's about dragging it out. And as long as there are these court cases going, Kayleigh McEnany can go on Fox News and Trump can tweet about it and Fox News can run segments about it that they'll immediately have to either retract or ignore going forward when the claims are thrown out and the people admit that Project Veritas paid them to lie and all that. It seems like something is happening. And that's what the QAnon people need. That's what the really dejected Trump cultists need. They need to feel like something is happening, like there's still a chance. And they're all, again, it's like we said a week ago, they're just riding that high and just trying to stretch out the little bit of their supply they got left.
No, you're absolutely right. I mean, you mentioned Trump TV, and I think that's a very, very real possibility. But if you're gonna grift, and if your whole life has been a grift, you need this. You need to maintain that lie so that your followers, look, he would have followers no matter what. He could say, we lost, we're coming back. He could take it like a man, and whatever, masculinity is a prison and made up, but you know what I'm saying. Take it like an adult, right? But he doesn't. And you're absolutely right, because his base is so far gone, it's so fringe, and actually pretty stupidly, because we know that those 70 million people, I wish it was 70,000, 70 million people who voted for him, they're not crazy, sadly. A lot of them might just be racist. A lot of them might just think that it's okay for a president to behave in the way Trump does. But I don't believe that 70 million people are Q followers. So there absolutely is a reason to say you can continue this brand and still concede. But no, he wants it to be the craziest and most dangerous version of his brand, which just says we were wronged. Ergo, pretty much anything is justified, whether violence, whether, you know, whatever is to come, all that is justified, and especially is justified for me to build my, like, probably, let's be real, YouTube empire, because you know they're gonna take that money.
Fox News definitely hasn't liked how common Fox News sucks chants have become, whether it's outside of a ballot counting facility or indeed at the Million MAGA March, which history will remember as the 10 to 13,000 MAGA March. Here's video from this weekend. Okay, so I mean, that's just amazing, because Fox News, outside of like Chris Wallace, has been like their teeth have been embedded an inch deep into Trump's boots, and still it's not enough to please these people. And you know how I know that? I'm not just saying that. Take a look at how they're advertising. So here is a little like promo news bumper thing that they played, and get a load of what they want to reassure their audience of.
Fox News, the voices America trusts.
These legal efforts are critical.
There are apparent irregularities. The media mob and the Democrats, they lied.
Speaking up for you and the issues that matter most to the people.
They thought there would be a blue wave. Not the case.
You're gonna see something even bigger than Trump in 2022 and 2024.
The truth does need to come out.
Can we speak freely again? Can we have America back?
We, the people, deserve better.
Fox News, America is watching.
Can we speak freely again? Can we have our country again? Can we have our audience again? Come on, guys, stop being mean to us. No, seriously, we believe all of the crazy stuff you believe. Dominion, sure, you wanna see another shadow hand puppet? We can bring those on. Whatever crazy thing you believe, we've got people who are just as crazy. That's what I got out of that promo.
Absolutely. Hey, America, do you have a Trump flag? Why don't you bend over and I will give you a rim job right now? I am so sorry, but that's exactly what that was. That was a rim job to the most craziest among you. Yes, it tastes good. Like, this is not okay. What are you doing?
What are you doing?
Why are they even doing? People are still gonna watch them.
They must be worried. I don't know. I'm not Donald Trump. I don't live my life tracking the ratings every day for networks I'm not on. Are they down? I don't know. That ad to me implies that somebody is nervous. It might not be the talent necessarily, quote unquote. It might just be their manager. It might be their ad set. I don't know. But they're projecting to me that they're worried.
But like, don't you love, you just said that, and we know when advertisers have jumped ship, major advertisers have jumped ship, it's because Fox News is saying some racist BS, right? Yeah. Like, so they're not worried when that happens. But then when people are like, Fox News sucks, that like freaks them out. I mean, it is also just like so painful, because as someone on the left, as someone who, you know, we've criticized mainstream media all the time, right? And you think they ever take our critiques to heart? No, never. They don't want us at all.
That's
but
true.
But one little chance and this major most watched network capitulates and just rolls out the red carpet for these nut jobs. Meanwhile, we crazies on the left want to survive the climate apocalypse. Yeah. Sorry. Like,
exactly.
Oh, it's so sad. It's just so sad to me.
It is. And what's really amazing about it is that in the same way that, like, you know, Donald Trump or his son will always be like, CNN sucks, New York Times sucks, Washington Post is fake. And I will demonstrate it by this article. I'm linking to the Washington Post here. Like, it's always sort of funny how they use the thing they're mocking.
Right.
So these right wingers who are, they're mad that, like, there's like the back end, just the little back end of some of these Fox host tongue isn't pressed against the boot. They're gonna jump ship from Fox. Meanwhile, YouTube, which is currently allowing false conspiracy theories about the election to run rampant, videos racking up millions of views about it, about 40% feature clips from Fox News.
Jeez.
So like, they're using it to show that this thing is rigged and then complaining that Fox isn't saying enough that it was rigged. Now, there's another twist to this, though, because I don't have the numbers. I can't say how badly Fox is bleeding. But from the activity of one of their sharks in the ocean, it seems like they smell blood. Take a look at this little recent segment from OAN.
We are looking at the latest, most up-to-date tally of electoral votes in the 2020 presidential race. We here at One American News are the only ones providing truthful, accurate numbers, as we believe President Trump, as you can see, still has a chance of winning.
As you can see from this map that we designed in Windows Paint in 1994. Seriously, where is your graphics package coming from? What font is that? Anyway, but look at that. They're calling states, like for instance, Brian Toshman on Twitter acknowledged that they called North Carolina for Trump, where he has a 75,000 vote lead, but they're pretending that Michigan is undecided when Biden has 115,000 vote lead. Right. I mean, the whole thing is absurd, but they're saying we're the only ones telling you the truth. Wink, wink, Fox is a bunch of traitors and they've turned against Q or whatever.
I don't even ever wanna talk about OANN. Honestly, I don't need to, like, if you're gonna lie to me and have lots of propaganda, just like zhuzh it up a bit, you know, get more money. They probably will, I have no doubt, but like, honestly, trash. I don't like, let's just not, like, whenever they say something, let's just not.
Yeah.
Let's not. I mean, this is funny, but I really hope that they don't become more relevant.
I hope so too. Okay, so I'm not gonna make you talk about OAN. I'm gonna, for just one more second, but I will say Fox and apparently OAN do a thing that will seem a little bit foreign, perhaps, to certainly to me, maybe to Francesca too. And that is doing a show for an audience of one. Like, if I do a video, I don't expect that Bernie Sanders is going to watch it. If I do a video, I don't expect that AOC is gonna watch it. Do I hope? Sure, but I don't expect it. They expect it though, and there's a reason. It's because it works. So they do segments like that on OAN, and the president of the United States, the most powerful person in the world, says, try watching OANN, really great. Cause he saw that and he liked it. They're pretending the thing he wants them to pretend, that he still has a chance when he doesn't. And if they will, you know, pluck out their own eyeballs with tweezers and stick their head in the sand, he will reward them for that thing that somehow passes for loyalty.
I mean, yes, and the sad thing is that I don't know what's gonna happen, but what I will say that the Democrats will absolutely pretend that this kind of sludge doesn't exist. they'll do what I just said, which is like, let's not pay attention to them. But we actually kind of do need to. And especially when it comes to places like YouTube, you know, I think it is a domain that we have fought for, which I think is really important, that TYT has fought for and done incredibly well. And I think more and more having progressive news alternatives on YouTube is really, really critical. But you can't go forward having 40%, you know, or having a, you know, however many, you know, hundreds of thousands of videos that are just about lies, you know.
Yeah.
And I don't know, maybe they have the exact same warnings that Twitter has been putting up. Maybe they are, you know, grayed out, whatever it is. You got to say you're 18 or older, maybe. Which we all do. like whatever. like what are the precautions going forward to prevent some of these completely fake news outlets from running rampant as we have seen they have been and got Trump and others elected?
Yeah. I don't know going forward, but I do know that Democratic leadership, probably including Joe Biden, they either don't understand or don't acknowledge the threat inherent in a lot of this stuff. They are still living in, like, I dream that they're living in the 90s. I fear that they're living in the 80s or maybe the 70s, but they don't get the modern threats that we face. They just don't get it. If you want to know how the pandemic is going in America, all you need to know is that America had more than 1 million reported cases in less than 6 days. Let's pause for a second on that. Didn't even take a week for a million new cases. And that is, I think, by any standard, an insane failure. But imagine if in those first days where we locked down and everybody was so terrified and they're going and stockpiling toilet paper, if you had told them that, like 8 months later, we're going to have failed so bad that we're having a million new cases a week, even after all of this time, after all of these deaths, after all of these cases. Just amazing. Take a look. NBC News did a great listing of each day in November and look at the rise in cases there. 76,000 on the first was an insane number, and we're having double that. And in fact, on Sunday, which is always the lowest day, sometimes Monday, but Sunday is pretty low too. We had 139,000 cases. We had 583 deaths reported on a Sunday when many states don't even report. Still, on the lowest day, we had 583 deaths. And we have more on this. But really fast, I know that this isn't a new story, Francesca. How many times have we entered into a Monday with bad news like this? But this is just terrible. I mean, this is the most cases we've had this entire time.
Yeah, it is seriously frightening. And I without trying to, you know, reduce your own anxiety and get a good night's sleep however you can, we should still be very concerned and take so many precautions. Look, Thanksgiving is coming up. I know people are going to see their family members. Please try not to make that either a long visit or a visit with many family members. Make sure you test and everyone tests. And I know that's hard to get people to test. But if they won't test, then you wear masks inside. Sorry, it's weird, but you're gonna do it. Or, you know, you have an outdoor heater, you got a patio, cool, that's even better. But no, this is what you have to do to keep your loved ones alive and safe. And if you need to skip it, you skip it, right? I know a lot of folks' families are a plane ride away. Maybe you should just skip it. And that is hard because we're in this moment where we wanna be close to one another. We're suffering because we aren't close to one another. So, it's just the sacrifice we have to keep making, thinking of our healthcare workers, thinking of the people who've died, thinking about how we want our family members to not die. Everyone knows someone at this point and will continue to know people. So, you know, we come off the back of talking about all of these senseless and ridiculous lawsuits that the Trump administration is pursuing. And you just imagine if he turned that energy into actually trying to save people's lives. And it makes you just even more furious and angry.
But
it's pathetic. This is so pathetic that we can't, that we're not doing this. And also, last thing, it makes a case for having a health body that is completely separate from the government. Yes, there would have to be some kind of, like, you know, in working in tandem, but what if we had, like, kind of, you know, like what if the CDC was more independent? You know, what if we didn't have to politicize anything? Because this is not gonna be the last time that we go through this, sadly.
Yeah. No, it probably won't be. It won't be. But no, Trump isn't gonna change here. Fauci said he hasn't been in one of the meetings in months. Oh, by the way, they're blocking the pandemic coordinating team from talking with Biden's transition team. They're stopping that from happening because it doesn't matter to them. They don't care, and they don't care if more people die. And the way I think about it now, especially with we're gonna get to the vaccine in just a few. Like, they apparently have developed vaccines that are relatively effective with relatively low incidence of side effects. And those will come at some point. We don't know exactly when. We don't know when regular people will be able to get them, but they are coming. And it makes me think of, like, you know, in beyond the last two decades, when you go back, there would be wars and lots of people would die in the wars. And at some point, the war would end. Some two elites would get together in a room and they'd end it. And because of the way communication worked, there would be days or weeks before some people in some battlefields found out about it, and they would still be fighting and dying. Needlessly, because the war doesn't even exist anymore. We know that there's a vaccine. The question is, how many more people will die between now and when we actually get it? How many more people? Anybody watching this, do you want to get sick and deal with, you know, long-term organ failure? Do you want to potentially give it to one of your family members? Do you want to lose a friend or family member needlessly when we know that the effective cure is coming if we just are a little bit patient? And if we just unfortunately treat Thanksgiving like we treated Halloween and like we treated the 4th of July, it'll be okay. Yes, it sucks to feed 1 year to this monster, but there will be other years if we're responsible. If we're not, then maybe there's no more Thanksgivings for us. Maybe our grandma doesn't get to do another Christmas. And so that's the question that everybody is gonna have to face. It would be great to do a Thanksgiving in person and get to experience all the stress of setting that up and people flying in and getting in fights about politics. It would be great to have that horrible experience, but maybe not worth it. Maybe not worth it. I saw this thread from someone working COVID cases that really just breaks my heart. It's from Jody During, who said, "I have a night off from the hospital. As I'm on my couch with my dog, I can't help but think of the COVID patients the last few days. The ones that stick out are those who still don't believe the virus is real. The ones who scream at you for a magic medicine and that Joe Biden is going to ruin the USA, all while grasping for air on 100% Vapotherm. They tell you that there must be another reason they're sick. They call you names and ask why you have to wear all that stuff because they don't have COVID because it's not real. Yes, this really happened. And I can't stop thinking about it. These people really think that this isn't going to happen to them. And then they stop yelling at you when they get intubated. It's like an effing horror movie that never ends. There's no credits that roll. You just go back and do it all over again. I stupidly thought that once the people get it, they open their eyes and realize it's true. But why would that be the case? They've been inoculated, not against the virus, but against acknowledging that the pandemic is real. And so they go into their last days and indeed they die believing that the thing killing them is a hoax by CNN or China or Bill Gates or whatever. And these doctors have to see it and they have to watch this cycle play out every single day.
You know, someone should lay body bags at the footsteps of Fox News and the White House because this is on them. This is on OAN. This is on all of the grifters, the conspiracy theorists, the people who know better, the people who are given information on a daily about why this and how this virus is real. All of these bodies are at Donald Trump's feet. All of these bodies are at Tucker Carlson and Laura Ingraham and Sean Hannity's feet.
Yep.
I swear to God. That's it.
Yeah.
And it's sad to see someone, you want to get mad at that person, you want to say kind of like, well, you know, get what you asked for, etc. But then you realize that they have been fed poison. I mean, it's not just the actual coronavirus, but just mental and informational poison for so long, even when the president who had COVID, who might still be contagious, who's infected 130 Secret Service members, who has infected so many people in the White House, like even he was denying it as he got it. Yep. And absolutely that person lying there is like, yeah, give me the magic medicine because it helped the president. No, buddy, that's not for you. You're a casualty in this war on truth and that's what it is, that's what you get. You don't get it. You don't get healthcare. You think this president's got a plan for healthcare? No. So it is, you know, if you can't get through to these people, you gotta stay away. You really have to keep your distance from them.
I agree. All of these people, if they're on a ventilator denying that it exists, you think they were wearing a mask, you think they were protecting their family members. It's sad that they're dying because, as you said, they've been poisoned by these murderous grifters in the right-wing media. But they also spread it to other people, undoubtedly, and got them sick. And those people will suffer with it for the rest of their life, assuming the rest of their life hasn't already ended. Yeah, I guess, you know, if we're too specific, maybe we'll get in trouble. You know, I had my early on, I wrote an op-ed for The Hill, the only op-ed I've ever written for The Hill that they didn't publish, laying out how irresponsible Fox News is being and how it's gonna get people killed. Yeah. And they wouldn't publish it, and it has been, that was like 2 months into the pandemic, and it has been proven true a couple hundred thousand times over. Yes. They knew what they were doing when they spread this misinformation, and they will never suffer any liability for it. There will never be any consequences for Laura or Sean or Tucker, but they know what they did, and I'm not going to forget at the very least.
Yeah.
Every once in a while, I will say that this is the saddest or most shocking graphic that I've read. This one is up there with about the saddest thing that I've ever heard, and it has to do with the cost of this misinformation, people not being responsible. I want to talk about a party. Only 55 people attended a party on August 7th at the Big Moose Inn in Millinocket, but one of those guests arrived with a coronavirus infection. Over the next 38 days, the virus spread to 176 other people. Seven of them died. None of the victims who lost their lives had attended the party. So someone went to the party and began spreading COVID, and it spread and it killed a handful of people who hadn't even been there.
Yeah.
That is how this works. This pandemic, we showed you those numbers of cases or whatever. All those numbers are thousands of those parties of people not caring or thinking they're immune or thinking, I'm being kind of responsible, and it spreads and it spreads and it spreads. You can't get to numbers like that without thousands of people thinking that the rules don't apply to them, and people die. And all too often, and it sort of proves that karma doesn't exist, it's not just those people or not even those people who actually die. It's people who were being responsible in the end who die.
And this is, you know, back to YouTube. I like that this thread is continuing here. Because look, when we've always been told if the government doesn't step in, private corporations do. Let's put all of our energy and faith into the private, you know, private corporations, these entities, they're motivated by goodwill and the invisible hand of the market will deliver what the people need. Okay, well, guess what? Every single pre-roll ad on YouTube should be bought by YouTube about COVID. That's it. That is it. If the government hasn't bought purchase ads on these videos, it should be YouTube itself that is putting out COVID information, correct COVID information.
That's a good point.
And explaining to people. Instead, no, we got the Epoch Times with like a corny, like a corny dude who's just like, guess what? I have the truth. Like, just seriously though, like we, you know, the emergency broadcasting service, all of these things, like even we just better need to utilize the airwaves and the internet for spreading actual true information. Whose job is that if the government has abdicated their role?
Yeah. Yeah, you know, like they couldn't do that for one day. Like just say, you know what, we're not running other people's ads. We're running our own ads, and it's not just gonna be on COVID misinformation. It's gonna be on literally every video, and we're gonna lose 1/365th of our advertising revenue for YouTube. And it might save some lives. That's a great idea. They should 100% do that. Anyway, this whole thing is so sad. The people like going to their deaths, not believing it, spreading it, the people dying who like they saw someone who saw someone who thought going to a party was a good idea. As of this morning, one of the vaccines that's being worked on, the Moderna vaccine, has apparently been shown to be 94.5% effective against the coronavirus, according to early data released by the company just today, making it the second vaccine in the US to have a very high success rate. Dr. Anthony Fauci replied to that news saying these are obviously very exciting results. It's just as good as it gets. 94.5% is truly outstanding. The company says its vaccine did not have any serious side effects. A small percentage of those who received it experienced symptoms such as body aches and headaches as well. This is all information about the side effects and the success rate coming from the company. Yeah. So just bear that in mind, and there will be more testing and all of that. But in addition to the Moderna one, last week Pfizer announced that early data shows its vaccine is more than 90% effective against the disease, which obviously either of those or both of those being available would be game changers. But we also need a lot more information, and it's going to take literally forever for it to be made available.
And it should be free, and it shouldn't gouge the American taxpayer. Yes, and those things, that those are things that early on Bernie Sanders was calling for. They still, that still needs to be the case. I mean, let's be real, these are people who've gouged us for regular meds for many, many, many decades now. So hey, they kind of owe us. But you know, yeah, 94.5, that's great. And the side effects, those are side effects that you can get from a flu shot as well. So
yeah,
this is good news for sure.
Yeah, yeah. And actually, you know what? I don't know why I would even give him any credit. I saw Trump tweeted something about like, remember, this was under my watch. And I immediately fact checked it because I remembered that the other vaccine, he'd been bragging about some vaccine development, and it was one that wasn't in the Operation Warp Speed. Like it had, he had nothing to do with it, whatever.
Right.
In this one, they apparently did give them like $1 billion. So that's good. Look, one thing that he probably had absolutely nothing to do with that somebody on the team suggested, good. That might have helped, maybe. And now we need to actually get it. And you know, that same credit that I just gave him, let me take it back, because again, this is a guy who cares so little about this that he's not going to any of the meetings. He doesn't talk about the coronavirus anymore, really. And he has blocked the team that's working on the coronavirus in the government from coordinating with Joe Biden, because of course he cares more about pretending he won the election than your grandma living or dying.
Yeah.
Cannot believe that it is mid-November and it's worse now than it was. Just can't believe it. Over the last few days, the new congressional orientation has begun, and that's led to a lot of great photos and everything, but it's also led to a little bit of just learning stuff about the people that rule us that is deeply depressing. And this lesson is brought to us via Cori Bush. So Cori Bush had tweeted things like this. This picture saying change does not come from this place unless we bring it here ourselves. We're bringing change to the 117th Congress. It's an awesome photo, a reminder that like after working as an activist, she's made it. That is awesome, and she's remembering the issues that brought her there with Breonna Taylor's name on her mask there. Unfortunately, not everybody got that message because she later tweeted, it's day one, so I'm wearing my Breonna Taylor mask. A few of my Republican colleagues have called me Breonna, assuming that's my name. It hurts, but I'm glad they'll come to know her name and story because of my presence here, which is getting me mildly choked up just a little bit. Breonna must be central to our work in Congress. So you all know this story, it's from a couple of days ago, but there was literally no way we were not gonna do it on the show. Republican congressman thought she was Breonna Taylor. Because they also apparently think that people put their own name on their mask. They don't recognize that name at the tail end of a year where there have been countless thousands of protests about her. News coverage about her and what happened to her. Updates on the trials about what happened to her and the injustice continuing. They in late November thought, oh, you're Breonna Taylor. Okay, cool, welcome. Welcome to Congress. How much does that say? Getting that wrong, making that mistake, it tells you so much about these people.
Yeah, and also tells you so much about Cori Bush that instead of, you know, obviously that's enraging and hurtful and kind of racist and ridiculous, that she was like, it hurts, but I know that I'm informing my colleagues about this case and who Breonna Taylor was and how she died. Like that is such an example of rising above these hurtful moments, and the fact that progressives in Congress are asked to rise above so much all of the time. I mean, this is one of sadly, I think many examples going forward that the incoming Congress people who are part of the squad a lot of them who are black, like Mondaire Jones and Jamal Bowman and Cori Bush, they're gonna be facing a lot of this kind of, you know, subtle, talk about microaggressions, right? Like racism, overt racism. You know, we know that the first two Muslim Congress people, female Congress people, Ilhan Omar and Rashida Tlaib, still face an incredible amount of Islamophobia. That's only going to continue. But yeah, it's ridiculous you wouldn't have heard her name at this point. I wonder if, like, she had worn the name George Floyd, if they'd be like, hey, George, what's up? You know, like, so yes, that's how much of a non-reality, that's how unresponsive. And I'm sure some of those Republicans might have been from states where there have been these major incidents. And they have African-American constituents among them, you know, so. Who definitely know her name.
Yep. So if you've been wondering, were they listening? No, they were not listening. This is how you get no change when roughly half of our elected representatives are so checked out that they don't even know the small handful of names that have created and sustained the biggest social movement of literally our entire lives.
Yeah.
Deeply depressing. And deeply racist. If I had come in with a mask that said Ahmaud Arbery, they wouldn't assume that was my name. They did it because she's black. And they just assumed, that's probably her. They don't care. Anyway, just a couple more graphics. She tweeted, I am Breonna Taylor, as far as I could be a black woman murdered in my bed tonight. But I am not Breonna Taylor. She was murdered and still has not received the justice she deserves. It's just, God, it just kills you how little our elected representatives care. Care about what's going on. Get them all, get rid of all of them. And it's so hard, it's so hard. And it really does feel sometimes like we're backtracking. Like for every photo like this, you know, there you got Jamal Bowman, Senator Nakima Williams joining her there. It's awesome and it's inspirational. Then you also have things like this. Marjorie Taylor Greene saying our first session of new member orientation covered COVID in Congress. Masks, masks, masks. I proudly told my freshman class that masks are oppressive. In Georgia, we work out, shop, go to restaurants, go to work and school without masks. My body, my choice. I'm sure that she was proud when she said it. Proudly ignorant, that's America. Proudly stupid. Proudly risking your own life and the lives of people around you. So proud of your ignorance, your willful ignorance. So you have people like Cori Bush facing this, at the very least, placid, subtle, uninterested racism. And then we also have people like Marjorie Taylor Greene, people who believe that Cori Bush, because she's a Democrat, is a satanic pedophile. And we all know that about her. We know that she's anti-Semitic and, you know, xenophobic and all that. All those videos are freely available and Republicans just voted her in. And so for every Jamal Bowman, maybe you get a Marjorie Taylor Greene. That's America, effectively.
Absolutely. Also, like, how much do you expect to get done in your first session if no one will come anywhere near you because you refuse to wear a mask? Like, cool story, you know? Like, it's so funny. She's like, I told my freshman class that masks are oppressive. Like, first of all, for those of you who remember college, you know, there was always that one girl who was like, well, I was reading in Vogue that, and you're like, we're in a Middle East studies class, girl. Like, what are you talking about? Like, this is like Marjorie Taylor Greene is that woman who is just like, no one ever told her she was wrong. And here we go, you know. And the other thing, she tweeted a video of her working out in her hotel room as like a way to show off that she like does CrossFit. And she was like, because DC gyms are closed. They're not closed apparently, but you do have to wear a mask, which she won't do. This is the kind of person who's going to get so many people sick. This is the kind of person who deserves body bags, you know, at her doorstep, because she will absolutely kill people.
And as a continuing demonstration of how her brain is slightly smooth, she was complaining about the fact that she couldn't work out in DC, even though, as you say, she could. She could go to the gyms, she's just choosing not to because retweets are more important than just living your life the way you say you want to. But also, the video is her working out and doing a workout in a room, evidence that you can work out at home. It seems to be working for you. Look at that. You're so proud of that workout, you're sharing it to the world. But some people will like it. Some people just want a video like that. I remember your tweet, Franny. Anyway, okay. God, it's so sad. Anyway, Cori Bush, thankfully she's on the inside. Hopefully she can get great things done. You know what you should be worried about today? One of the most important issues facing America. What sort of garment Harry Styles wraps his lower body in? At least according to Candace Owens, who responded to the fact that he had been on the cover of a magazine wearing something like a dress by saying, "There is no society that can survive without strong men. The East knows this. In the West, the steady feminization of our men at the same time that Marxism is being taught to our children is not a coincidence. It is an outright attack. Bring back manly men." So what sent her into this downward spiral? This photo of Harry Styles. So I don't, if the news didn't demand it of me, I would never talk about Harry Styles. I don't care about Harry Styles. He had a pretty good episode of SNL. I've never listened to any of his music. I'm gonna guess that a lot of women probably look at that photo and think, not bad, if I had to guess. Mm-hmm. But that right there, that's the downfall of society. Bring back manly men. Like Donald Trump and Tucker Carlson, bring him back. We can't survive without, but he doesn't, he's not even American, I don't think. Isn't he from the UK? Like, we got our own things to worry about. You know, people are dying of COVID. They don't have health insurance, buried student loan debt. The economy's not doing so well. But oh, we should worry about Harry Styles. We have more, Francesca, including some other takes from right wingers. But what do you think about Candace Owens' fashion critiques there?
I mean, look, man, you got a bunch of proud boys who can't wear big boy pants marching through the streets of DC, aggressing on anyone they come across with. They're all manly men. They got AR-15s, right? Isn't this what we're supposed to celebrate? Just unmitigated violence and toxic masculinity. It is so sad where the BS myth of manly men has gotten us. Now about this photo, notice the only thing that feels effeminate, the only thing is that it's a big jacket, a like trendy cool jacket that someone decided to just drape in a V. That's it, that's really all it is. If he had pulled it all the way up to his neck and exposed his clearly amazing body, it would have been fine. You're triggered by an angle, straight up, that's okay. It.
No, look, for Annie. So look, there are other photos of him where he's in something that's much more clearly a dress or whatever. But again, like, who cares? Who cares? You're right. That outfit, like, I have a feeling he's draping it off himself because he likes his body. You know, some guys are blessed with their bodies. Harry Styles, Donald Trump, some of them just got it, you know, and they want to flaunt it. And so he's flaunting it.
Yeah, but this is the other thing though. And this is, I think, look, when it comes to gender nonconformity and really imploding the gender binary, which we know triggers the right like crazy, this is the stuff. Like, this is what they go for. And that's really what Harry Styles like meant to do. You know, it's like, yeah, get triggered, freak out because I'm wearing a dress. Do you know, does it matter whether my sexuality, whether I like men or women? No. Does my gender matter? No. And I think this is this generational divide that, like, man, even when I was in school, we didn't have that kind of like understanding or openness, but I think young Zoomers truly do, that your presentation of your sexuality and your gender have nothing to do with one another. Your presentation of whatever you want to wear, it's like more power to you. If you can pull it off, it's fly. You know, so, and I love that. I love that about, I think, what an embrace of, and what really queer culture has done to this country is really allow us to let go of the gender binary so strongly that has wrongly defined us, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Now, yes, there's more on this. You know, it would be one thing if Candace Owens just sat out there by herself looking like an idiot, but this is right wing grift and there's money to be made here. So others are gonna jump in front to make clear to their audience that they're just as stupid in this way. And so we've got a couple, including manly men such as Ben Shapiro, who says to her comment, "This is perfectly obvious. Anyone who pretends that it is not a referendum on masculinity for men to don floopy dresses is treating you as a full on idiot. I subscribe to all of this. I believe that this is what men should be like." Matt Walsh says, "Candace Owens is trending because a bunch of whiny idiots are mad that she said men who wear dresses aren't manly. So look at the flaccid mental jujitsu right there. The people who are pushing back against her attacking Harry Styles, they're whiny. Her totally bringing up out of nowhere his magazine cover, that's not whiny. Her implying that any man would dare to wear clothes she doesn't approve of, that's not whiny. It's people who are just responding to her like, dude, just live your life. Or like maybe my opinion is considered whiny, where I say, I think the very idea of a real man is stupid. Like as Francesca said, it's a self-imposed prison that means literally nothing. But if there is a real man, you know what real men don't do? Go around worrying a lot about what other men wear on their legs. Yes. I don't think a strong alpha man is like, a skirt, how could you? I don't think that's what they do. I just don't.
Ben Shapiro, what an emblem of masculinity. You know, when I think masculine, manly man, I think, you know, just a higher octave than letting a balloon air out, you know, just like, you know, but like imagine if that were a person, like, that's Ben Shapiro. That is the manliest man, the guy who doesn't like WAP because it scares him. doesn't even think WAP is a thing. But also, can I just make a plug for floofy dresses? Okay, everyone should wear a floofy dress in their lifetime. As a teenager, I would go into Bloomingdale's, try on all the floofy dresses, not buy a single one, just to sort of feel pretty and whatever, and like wear something you'd never wear ever, 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 ever. Every man, woman, child, and in between should wear a floofy dress. I think everyone should wear a suit. I love suits. I think they look amazing. I've never really like pulled off a nice suit, but like, ooh, they're so clean and beautiful. But same with floofy dresses. Wear a floofy dress. Go into a Bloomingdale's, go into a dressing room, get a, you know, whatever size you need, try it on.
Yeah.
It'll make you feel better. I mean, maybe when COVID is done, but it will make you feel better. I swear to God. Yeah.
I think that's a great idea. I also want to credit Manny Fidel on Twitter for agreeing with her, saying hell yes, bring back manly men like the founding fathers. those dudes are butch. You know, the man who single-handedly made America, let's take a look at him. That's a man. That's a real man. Look at my horse's butt. I'm a man. Because that's a
Mike Pence man right there.
The whole thing is just so stupid. And you know, people in the chat are talking about kilts, for instance. That's a great point. So Ben Shapiro, in his long chain of thoughts about this, says that's a stupid argument, but he doesn't actually engage with it. He gets that it's out there, that yes, there are cultures where the manliest men wear things that are basically skirts or dresses, but he won't engage with it because that would require actually acknowledging that what is masculine or feminine changes over time and by geography. It's arbitrary, it shifts. It used to be that you'd wear a big dress, like a big wig, and you'd powder your cheeks and everything, and that was considered manly. It changes even within our own lifetime. What hairstyle is considered manly, all of it's arbitrary. Yeah. He doesn't want to actually open up his mind to that realization that none of it means literally anything. And to the extent that it does, if you have one man who literally could not put on a dress without feeling so nervous and concerned about what people think about him, and another man who can, masculinity is stupid, but that guy clearly has more of whatever it is. He's clearly more comfortable with himself. And that at the end of the day is what we're talking about. We're talking about people accruing a sense of confidence and competence, and that has nothing to do with your gender or your identity or anything. It's something that all of us has to come to grips with, but they are very scared about that. They want constrained rules that they can sort of follow and then feel comfortable. Like, I've done it. I've done what I had to do to be considered a man.
Yo, Photoshop Ben Shapiro's face on every single Vogue cover and tell me by the end of the week if he's not like, I love that. That's amazing. I wore that better than Beyonce. Like, he would love it. It's jealousy. It is absolute jealousy. The fact that Harry Styles pulled it off, the fact that he was unafraid to do it, and that you're just stuck in your own little prison is jealousy. Candace Owens is on some other BS. Candace Owens is like literally just finding ways to still be relevant.
Yeah, yeah. No, there's definitely a sense of desperation to it. Yeah, and by the way, just two other quick thoughts. One, go track down Jordan Yule's tweet about this because he points out that we should bring back Manly Man, and he has an awesome photo of Ken Klippenstein. Anyway, but then also, and this is just an appeal. I do it every once in a while to any of the, whether you're a Trump fan or just a conservative who's watching this. When I attack conservative masculinity, I am not necessarily attacking you. I probably am. I'm not necessarily attacking you. I'm not saying necessarily that conservatives are betas or cucks, to use your terms. I'm just saying the guys you choose to represent you are 100% beta cucks. You're like, seriously, like Tucker Carlson, Matt Walsh, Ben Shapiro, all these are your, like, you guys care about masculinity more than literally anything. And these are the guys that you choose to represent you. I'm not saying anything, I'm just saying.
Yeah, Tucker Carlson wore a bow tie for years. Really? Really?
Now,
okay.
If he had pulled it off, awesome. You know who probably could pull it off? I bet Harry Styles probably looks pretty good in a bow tie. But Tucker, you didn't. And you were too stupid to realize it for years until Jon Stewart forced you to take a look in the mirror. And you didn't like what you saw. Anyway. Francesca, thank you as always.
John, thank you. Have a great week.
You too. Where can people see more of your work?
Oh yeah, we'll watch the latest episode of News Broke. We talk all about how to prevent a future Donald Trump, and that all depends on the Democrats. That was our last episode of the season, so definitely watch that. And because we're a new show that doesn't have the budget of John Oliver's show. Otherwise, I'd probably continue. Yeah, and listen to the Bituation Room wherever you get your podcasts and on my YouTube channel, Franny Fio.
Well, the funny thing is that John Oliver does have the budget of a John Oliver, and they're not continuing for now. They'll be back in February or something.
John,
but it was a great episode.
Iderella doesn't understand the concept of a vacation, so.
I understand a vacation. I don't understand like a 3-month vacation. There's still news, dude. He's not gonna come back until after the inauguration. No, like, and I remember in 2016, he did one episode after Trump got elected, and then he was gone for months. It's bananas.
Yeah.
But anyway, maybe it's not up to him. Okay, Francesca, thank you so much. Talk to you soon.
Thank you.
So we're just a couple of weeks out from the election. You know, all of the vote counting hasn't even concluded. And so while we would like to be able to draw a lot of lessons about how the election went, why it went that way, why there wasn't this massive landslide, we don't have all of the data necessarily yet to be able to say. But I think we can say with some confidence that it was probably the left's fault that it didn't go better, that we didn't win all those races. It wasn't a massive landslide. It was probably them. Something, something socialism is the theme of the day. And joining us to answer for her contribution to the massive failure of the Democrats is the executive director of the Justice Democrats, Alexandra Rojas. Welcome back to the show.
Thank you so much for having me, John.
Thank you. Now, I'm being very serious right now, except that I'm not. So what I'm alluding to there is that many of the, you know, there are elected Dems who had their little phone call complaining that their races were closer, some of them lost, and it has to do with the Green New Deal or defund the police and all of that. I'm sure you've had to talk about this a lot, so I apologize. But what do you make of that argument so far based on the data that we've seen?
Yeah, well, thanks again for having me on. I mean, we actually teamed up with New Deal Strategies, the Sunrise Movement, Data for Progress to release a memo on why, you know, we think what went wrong for Democrats in 2020. And totally agree that I think a lot of these sort of assertions of what went wrong and what went right are sort of premature, given that we haven't even gotten all of the election results yet. But given that, you know, we're seeing, you know, congressional Democrats in leadership to those that are either have lost or are still, you know, waiting for all of the ballots to be counting in their races, that they, you know, are blaming socialism, they're blaming defund the police. One, an attack that has been levied for decades, another one that just happened this past summer. And what we talked about in the memo was focusing on three main things. One, investing in the base, right? However people feel, have feelings about defund the police, the reality is the reason why we are competitive for two Georgia seats, up for two Senate seats in Georgia, and, you know, had resounding victories in places like Arizona and Georgia, Philadelphia, right? All of these key swing areas are because of young Black people, young communities of color across the board, especially Black voters, Latino voters, Native voters out in places like Arizona that are showing out in historic numbers, especially young people, the highest turnout we have seen in generations. And so to sort of immediately vilify the base does not make sense, I think, for a party that's trying to build something long lasting at the base of voters that is delivering key victories. And also, the question that we should be asking is, if we know that these attacks are coming, what are we doing to prepare for them? We know that these are also stokes of racial resentment, right? Socialism, defund the police. And instead of letting the GOP have that lane, right? Because we know that when they occupy it, they're going to fill it with, you know, racist stuff. We have to have our own agenda. I think that, you know, there's plenty of studies that we've also linked to in that memo. And you may have seen it. It's been on Politico and a few other places, and I could send it around afterwards. But it's talking about how we should take on, you know, the GOP's divide and conquer tactics head on, and talk about racial unity and connect it with economic prosperity, and actually run on a real message that is going to improve people's lives, and not just talking about finding common ground or bipartisanship that aren't really things that are going to tangibly make a difference.
Exactly, and arguably are the sorts of campaign themes that other candidates ran on and lost in very high profile, very important Senate races. But we're going to ignore all of that. It was probably
Or have been running on for decades, right? Like this strategy has clearly not been working for the Democratic Party for a while. And you know, despite all of that, we still had record turnout, right? On the Republican side, but certainly on the Democratic side, it looks like Joe Biden's going to win by over 5 million votes by the end of this or more. And so we've got an obligation now to not abdicate our responsibility in Democratic leadership to really, you know, champion an agenda and paint a picture of what it's going to look like to improve people's lives, instead of just, you know, sort of scapegoating progressives and activists that are really delivering a lot of key victories in these swing states.
Yeah, and that scapegoating, it certainly did bother me. Like, you know, I feared that the left would be, you know, cast off after the election, but I figured they would at least wait until they make the cabinet to prove to us that they don't need us anymore. But we didn't get that long. You brought up some great information there about the campaign themes you're pushing for, the policies you're pushing for. I know that some of the most high profile leftist politicians who've run on those sorts of themes responded to this criticism. With, you know, like Representative Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez was saying that everyone who endorsed Medicare for All won re-election, saying that she had tried to coach some of these other people on how to advertise online and do those sorts of things, and had been rebuffed by many of them. There seems to be this unwillingness on the part of some of these centrists and the longer term Congress people have been around for a while to understand why that wins, but also to even take the help when it's offered, which seems ill-placed, I would say. What do you think about some of the pushback from people like Rashida Tlaib, AOC, Ilhan Omar to this initial attempt to frame what happened in that election?
Well, I mean, folks like Rashida Tlaib, Representative Ilhan Omar, they are also part of the sort of act, you know, representing the movement, the activist base that sent them to Congress, that are working with their constituents to deliver, again, key victories in places like Minneapolis, in places like Detroit, where I'm sure when all said is done, when we analyze the data, they are helping us win in those places. So to take leadership from them on what is working on the ground, what is working in their communities, to have that dictate what, in some way, the future of the Democratic Party is, as opposed to, you know, just listening for the direction of Representative Abigail Spanberger or Connor Lamb, who are saying in interviews that, you know, why try? You know, the Democratic Party can't stand for anything, you know, and that's just not a message that is going to work. We know that these attacks are coming, and instead of cowering away from the very folks that are, again, you know, stepping up in support of trying to defend Black lives when there is impunity by police officers, or a socialism argument that has just been around for generations, it's time for the Democratic Party to take a stand. Let's go on the offensive. Let's call out the GOP, Donald Trump, for the divide and conquer tactics that they're displaying for all of the American people and focus on, you know, folks like Jeff Bezos, corporations that are robbing America, that are robbing working families blind in the middle of the pandemic, and working with, you know, folks like Mitch McConnell in Congress instead of, you know, some of the other things in addition to blaming us are talking about things like working with Mitch McConnell, or that's going to be a possibility when it's been years since we've been able to get anything done. And in the midst of a global pandemic, to expect that anything is going to be different is just ridiculous.
Well, we're going to turn to that in just a second. Before that, though, I did want to congratulate both you and the organization, Justice Democrats, for your big wins. There were some significant ones. You know, people are now nationally getting to know people like Jamal Bowman and Cori Bush. Some Republican leaders are starting to know who Cori Bush is because they apparently think she's Breonna Taylor for some reason, which just horrifies me to hear. But what do you think about this new class of Congress people coming out of Justice Democrats? What effect do you think they're going to have going forward?
Well, I mean, I am just, like I'm sure so many people, so excited to see Cori Bush, Jamal Bowman, Marie Newman getting sworn into Congress, some Justice Democrats come January. It is after many, many months of hard work, I'm sure from many folks watching this, small dollars, volunteer hours. So I hope for all of you, we all can feel so proud to have sent some of the few rays of hope. and obviously Joe Biden defeating Donald Trump, but in terms of new members to Congress, that we've sent some pretty cool people there together. But I think they're gonna have a seismic impact. I think if they weren't there, we can see you know, what the conversation might lead to. It is critical that we continue to work with the Biden and Harris administration to make sure that we follow through on the mandate that the American people sent him, which was to govern like the majority that's been given. And I think what that means, especially right now, is delivering on COVID-19 relief for prioritizing working families and not, you know, continuing to bail out corporations or, you know, say that there's not enough for families and businesses that really need it right now. And also push for everything we can possibly do on from climate change to immigration, but especially climate. So we actually teamed up with the Sunrise Movement to launch our climate mandate, which I think you were mentioning that we were going to get to in just a little bit.
Exactly. Well, why don't we start talking about that? Because you know, Joe Biden is apparently going to be president, assuming American democracy continues. Stay tuned, everybody. But he's won, and in the past, just, you know, about 2 weeks, he's put out a little bit of information about what he's going to do on climate, a little bit of information about what he's doing on COVID. We've got the choice of Ron Klain as his chief of staff. So, as you've been watching so far with the signals he's put out, and I know, you know, organizations like Justice Democrats and Sunrise Movement have their wish list of cabinet positions, the vast majority of which I think would be absolutely awesome. What do you think so far about the signals that have been given by Joe Biden and his team? And what are you going to be watching for to see how seriously they seem to be taking these issues that are at the core of Justice Democrats' political philosophy?
I mean, I think it's been mixed, but, you know, I think given the state of, as you pointed out, where our democracy is right now, it's been really encouraging to see Ron Klain, someone that has, you know, sent good signals to progressives about working with us to address, you know, to implement solutions that try to meet this moment, that bring us forward as opposed to backwards from where we are right now. I think that we've, you know, put out this climate mandate to be able to, obviously, you know, highlight some of our favorites like Deb Haaland for Secretary of Interior, and as well as a number of other cabinet positions. But we've also listed out multiple options in a good faith effort to do what you know we agreed to in the Biden Sanders Unity Task Forces as a movement, right, where we had representatives like Varshini Prakash and Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez come to an agreement on other things that we included in the climate mandate, like the Office of Climate Mobilization, which is going to be critically important and actually doesn't even need Senate approval to get started on, you know, orchestrating the massive effort that it's going to take, right, to solve this existential threat facing our country, and also that's going to affect every fabric of our society and economy. But we know that if we want to actually take serious about building the 21st century economy and society that we know we're going to have to prepare for impending things like climate change, we're going to have to address it. And the Office of Quiet But Mobilization, as well as appointing key progressive leaders that are strong on climate, that reject fossil fuel, executive money, and things like that, are in the administration. And again, we have our favorites, but we also left several options so that way the Biden-Harris administration can meet progressives, you know, where they're at. So we're really excited about those two things. But I think, again, critically, making sure that we are using this mandate that the American people have sent folks like Joe Biden, that we haven't seen in generations, right, since the last time FDR was elected, to make sure that we're not just, you know, co-governing with Mitch McConnell, who has completely dragged his feet. And again, we're worried about, you know, 2022 midterm depressing turnout if we give any, you know, some of these sort of victories to Mitch McConnell, that I think he's looking for Democrats to take the poison pill.
Yeah. Or in theory, spend the next 2 years trying to work with Mitch McConnell to no avail, the pandemic not really being addressed because of that, the economy not really being improved, and people rightfully blaming the people who are now in charge for not getting anything done. You mentioned you have some preferences for the cabinet. We also are getting signals from people like Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren that they're interested potentially in serving the cabinet. If they were to be blocked from that, if Joe Biden didn't put one or both in, would that be a strong signal to you that perhaps he would prefer to keep progressives a little bit at arm's reach on this whole path going forward?
Well, I mean, for both of those positions, we've listed several options. I think, you know, progressive leadership in this White House moving forward is going to be critical, despite where these leaders come from. But there are options besides those folks. But I think, you know, what's important is that we see some effort, right, from the Joe Biden administration. Like I said, it was very promising to see Ron Klain being appointed as chief of staff. And so we're hoping to see more to follow suit. But I think, you know, the Treasury Secretary, someone who is going to be in charge of our economy, is where progressives should be looking towards, right, when we're thinking about every single issue, whether it's rising income inequality or the direction of federal resources or how we're going to address this pandemic. Having someone like Senator Elizabeth Warren, who has been built for I think this moment, is going to be absolutely critical.
Okay. Well, you know, very excited to keep the conversation going forward with you as we, you know, see what sort of Biden administration we're going to have, what the relationship between them and the left is going to be. But I'm sure you're very busy. You probably got to start finding candidates for the midterms. So as always, Alexandra Rojas, we really appreciate not only you joining us on the show, but everything that you do day to day. You and your organization are absolutely awesome.
Thanks so much.
Thanks for listening to the full episode of The Damage Report. Support our work, listen ad-free, access members-only bonus content, and more by subscribing to Apple Podcasts at apple.co/TYT. I'm your host, John Adirola. I'll see you soon.